We have a gift in here that he said. And I said to Tamara, you can have them. Oh!
What do I get?
I think 2 milk, 1 sugar.
That's so bright.
Hi, can I get for you?
Hi, can I get a medium coffee with 2 milk and 1 sugar, please?
Okay.
Can I also get a medium iced coffee?
Okay.
That'll be everything.
$4.93, please.
Thank you. Tamara and I are headed to the airport to pick up some fish, some for me, some for her. Quick stop to grab a coffee. And of course, Tamara has to get her iced coffee so she can jingle it and annoy me.
All I can say is there better be a fish for me.
I have no idea, I forget. I don't remember this place at nighttime. It's been so long since I did an airplane order, like a shipped flight. I think that's a Gateway Cargo. Yeah, it's Westchin, see? Ready? Are you coming in?
I can come in.
Okay. Look at their tiny, tiny little sign.
It's that tiny little thing you gotta see from the highway.
There's no way. This is it. This is where I got all my fish for years. Oh, God. I think you rang for assistance? Then bring up the airway bill. Look at all those fish. That's lobster.
Those are lobster.
Yeah, those are all boxes of lobsters. You can tell by the pictures on them.
Hi there.
Hello, I'm here to pick up a box. It's fish. Should be under the name Mullen. I have the airway bill. 838-11033-374.
Perfect. And what was your name?
Mullen. Should be Joey Mullen. Great, thank you.
You're
welcome. See you now. Could have held the door. Jeez. Get your shot. That's it.
That's basically the process. After you've ordered your fish, you paid for them or whatever, or everybody, I guess, does that type of thing differently. But when you show up to pick them up at the cargo, say your plane's going to land at 7. Usually you want to be there about 7:30, 7:45, because they've got to take it off the cargo plane, get it here. And it's a lot of the times it's the same plane that a passenger plane. But once they have it, you show ID, you give them your airway bill number, you'll need that. That's it. When I was in Toronto for that scape off, I came across one of the vendors called Top Quality Fish. First thing I noticed, of course, was they had sold stingrays at their booth, or there were stingrays available. Further inspection, a discus, guppies, like the high-end stuff. And I'm always looking for high-end dealers that are trusted, and this guy came really highly recommended, so I thought, let's give it a shot. They're in Toronto. Ship all across Canada, of course. I'm not sure about the States, but I also think that you can just go find that out for yourself. Let's see, get this box out of here. I'll tell you why I ordered these fish, but first we gotta get them out. Make sure they're okay. That's some different type of packaging. Check that out. So each fish is kind of separated by a cardboard box. You rarely see that. Oh. But I do see what I, the whole reason for this order. It was one fish, and I seen it in person at the event before I said I needed to have it. Unbelievably good price. So the first one that I had to get was the one I saw initially. Look how healthy he is. Check, make sure that's a boy. It is, got the claspers. Look at this, pure black diamond stingray. Absolutely stunning. And he is eventually gonna go in with these guys at some point, probably within a year, but we gotta grow them out first, just to have some more genetics in that tank, because I think they're actually brothers and sisters, and the odds of raised breeding at brothers and sisters is typically pretty slim. The fish will come out okay. Fish can technically inbreed around 6 generations deep before you're gonna start to see severe deformities and quality issues or health problems. But since we look how clear that water is, lots of oxygen. I also like to review the shipping methods every time I order. Double bagged, that's what I'm looking for right now. This guy's so small, he's probably only a couple months old, but sometimes you could put airline over the barb so it doesn't pierce the bag. I think clipping them is kind of relatively popular, but you never rip them out. It'd be like ripping your fingernail out. Anyways, I start looking at the other rays that he has. And you guys remember, it wasn't too long ago, we went to One Fish, Two Fish in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, and there was a stingray there. Couldn't get it to eat. He had heater burn on top, on his denticles. And some people will confuse that for ammonia burn. They don't get ammonia burn on top. He was ammonia burned on the bottom though. Very red, this guy was emaciated, you can see his hip bones. And I said, look, let me have this guy. One day I'll give it back to you. And we kept it for 3 years, and then Jeff from One Fish, Two Fish got me another pearl to kind of pair them up. I grew them out and gave them back. I've always missed them, and I gotta be honest, abundantly honest, I tried to get them back for the 2000, and I said everything that I could. I offered him absolutely everything possible. And he's just like, no, that's why I got the 1350. That's why I sold you the 700. That's why I got the extra pearl in the first place. So he has his story. And my story is, I saved them. I raised them to be nice, big, and healthy. And I want them back. He said, no. In all fairness, that was the deal. So I'll get my own pearls. What do we got here? Oh, this is the boy. This is a male pearl. We're going to see them out of the bag here in a second. Absolutely stunning shipping. The water is not polluted. The rays are nice and chunky. The person that sells them is an actual hobbyist, so they could definitely spot and or feed stingrays properly. And then we got a darker female. Ooh, and the spotting on her. Just absolutely phenomenal. He had about 6 or 7 of these. Pearls are a beautiful ray with great patterns. They get relatively bigger than other rays. They're great eaters. They're not finicky. They will eat almost anything, including pellets. And I watched these guys are actually on pellets. But so are the Leopoldi, another great starter ray, except they're really expensive. And then the Motoro's up there as well. But the best eating stingray that I've ever experienced was definitely the Bosmani. I could have put a toilet in the tank and it would have ate. And that's one of the biggest things with stingrays is getting them to eat. Also going to, we have a gift in here that he said, and I said to Tamara, you can have them. Oh! Oh, wow. So these are higher end. So we got a male and a female beta. Ever since Tamara has been getting into betas, it's made me want them. She, of course, has 16 beta tanks. I'll leave a link to her in the description if you want to follow her along. We also have, I have more betas coming. I placed another order coming straight from Taiwan. This is the female. I don't know if I'll be able to get a good look at her because it wants to focus on me.
Beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful pair. I think these are placats, actually. Oh, look at the iridescence on this one. I've never seen high-end betas like this before. Like, this is really high-end. And what comes with that is expensive, too, probably. Offered to give it to me as a gift. And I was like, yeah, that'd be cool. But definitely going to give them to Tamara. Since I heat the gallery and not the aquariums, we're going to float these guys in their tanks. I don't know which tank she wants them in, but I'll just go chuck them in where I can. The rays are going to acclimate to the temperature of the gallery. Like I said, we heat the gallery, not the tanks. Oh, and she has a camera on one of the tanks. Recently added in some Indian almond leaves, and it's kind of tinted the water, but I guess they can just go anywheres, eh? I mean, it's just for now. Who's that? Let's put the female in with the bigger wood. Yeah, you're the male. Two there. And you there. So she has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 betas in the tanks right now. Oh, I named this one. Tamara's like, he flares a lot, so I called him Rick Flair. She calls him Ricky. Cool little tank though, eh? You guys watched me build this whole rack for her. So that's two. Now she has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 to go. She has, 7 to go. She has 4 on the way. Oh, beautiful. And I have a couple as well, but apparently they're not going to be here until October, which is a month and a half after we ordered them directly from Thailand. So you guys are going to poop your pants when you see these guys. I can't wait. I can't wait to see those guys out of the bag. But I'll let her unbox those, acclimate them, add them to the tanks. If you want a closer look at them, just check out the link in the description. Her channel's right there. Support her. She's taking, it's not that she's taking YouTube seriously. It's that she like really loves it and is finding so much joy and happiness in it. And her subscribers are just so supportive and they love her videos. She's actually really good at making the videos. So that's it's fun to watch. I watch them. And then I leave a sassy comment. But here we go with these guys. These guys are just absolutely gorgeous. All right, let's wait about 10 minutes. And then we'll acclimate. So we're going with the plop and drop method, essentially meaning we're going to take the ray, we're going to cut the bag open, we're going to pour that bag and its contents through this net. The water will go through the net, capturing the ray on its own, adding it to the tank. A lot of the times that is the best method to add freshwater fish to your aquariums. We do not want to mix the water here with the water there in case there's some sort of parasites or pathogens in it. Luckily, stingrays don't really carry parasites, externally at least, but they could have internal. So essentially we can't add them directly to an established aquarium, only due to the fact that they might have some sort of parasite. They do need to be quarantined, just like all fish need to be quarantined when you get them. The tank should be bare bottom. There should be no heater or exposed heater in the aquarium. The rays will go to it because it's the warmer area and they will get heater burn. So make sure your heater is covered and or in the sump or external or in line with the canister or something like that. So these guys are actually going in this 180-gallon tank for the time being. The Walru that were in it, we stripped this last night and I had to move the Walru to other 15 gallons, no problem, because they are going into the 2000. You might think, Joey, how are you going to be adding tiny little 1-inch fish to the 2000? I may or may not have been able to get my hands on some adults. This will be a temporary ray tank and or grow out for these guys for the time being. I do have my 70-gallon that we were supposed to add these into. Was going to be a pup grow out and I could have used that, but that's not connected yet. I still have to get that up and going, but for right now, I'm going to focus on these guys. This is a relatively simple and easy process. If you can have two people do it, that's great. One can actually hold the net, but if you don't, just know that the net can go flying, so be careful when you do this. And then there it goes, and up into the tank he goes. What about the drip method and acclimating him that way? The drip method is essentially slowly getting him used to the parameters in the aquarium. A lot of the times with little stingrays, he looks a little hungry. With little stingray or with stingrays in general, depending on how long they've been in shipping, In terms of adjusting to pH, that takes weeks for a fish. Obviously, you don't want to go from, alkaline, too high in alkaline to going into acidic. You can run into problems, and then you might want to drip acclimate. But this is alkaline water, and so is the tanks. So I'm not worried about that at all. Stingrays are a lifelong commitment. They can live 20, 25 years. They demand a massive diet and a massive tank. It's a huge financial commitment. Do I think everybody should get rays? No. Do I see like a lot of people keeping rays like that probably shouldn't? Yeah, so my duty is to kind of educate properly. And I think it's been like 7 years I've been asked for videos on how to keep freshwater stingrays, a tutorial. And of course, that's coming at some point. I gotta do it, man. These guys are gorgeous. It's not uncommon for a stingray to kind of just relax when they get in the tank, just swim to the bottom, not do much. But there will be a couple of things we're gonna be looking for. Activity is good, but it can be deceiving. If they kind of look like they're established in the tank and already kind of moving around like this one, that's fine. This is okay, that is okay. When they're just laying there doing absolutely nothing, that's fine. What we're looking for is disc curl. If the disc starts curling up, we could be into some trouble, but that's a sign of usually ammonia poisoning and or bad water quality. Stingrays don't react well to chemicals, so we're not going to be dosing this tank with anything, or especially depending on chemicals to keep them alive. We just need a bare bottom aquarium with good clean water, cycled filter, and they're gonna be fine. Look at the spotting on this guy. Now he's a little light, but he's gonna get darker and darker and darker. And those spots, I cannot imagine what they're going to turn into someday. So this guy looks to be newer than this one. I could tell how long these guys have been born or if they were imported or anything like that. And I could tell with this guy's barb, it's clipped. That is only having one barb. This guy has two barbs, but you can see the top one. Sorry. If you see the top one, you can see that it's still pointed, but the bottom one is older. And that's the one that was clipped for shipping. And this guy's just has one barb on top and a new one coming in on the bottom. If you can even see that. The end goal, of course, is to take him and maybe even get these guys obviously breeding at some point. It's probably gonna take a couple years. Same with him. Mix them in with my rays over here. Shut these lights off for you. And just see what comes from them. Look at the size of my female. Just an absolute beast. Everybody in this tank is just completely and totally gorgeous. And then at some point, all the pups will go into the 2000 and or I'll decide on some proper homes for them in the future with these. But this tank is just gorgeous. The rays are doing well. Even the little plants I added on, they're still kind of sort of where I put them, but I was just testing and seeing if I could have plants in there, just fake plastic plants. And they're kind of sort of where I put them, but might have to move them eventually. Now you'll notice in a ray tank, what's happened already. I put some sand in there and they just push it away from the front panel. They swim up the front sides and push it back, front, push it back. That's what they constantly do. I decided I would add a little bit of sand in there just for them to kind of play in it, but a stingray doesn't need sand in its tank for a couple of reasons. First and foremost, stingrays evolved over a million years to hide and or foraging for food or hiding from predators and or in the home aquarium. If your stingray is constantly under the substrate, a lot of the times it can indicate that the stingray is stressed out. It makes it more difficult for them to find the food, and I can assure you, if you want to clean a substrate in a massive stingray tank, you better have a tremendous amount of patience and time. It's gonna take forever. So a lot of times you will see monster tanks with bare bottom substrates in them. But when it comes to pups, definitely suggest going with bare bottom, just to make it easier for them to find the food. Since in the home aquarium, we're not gonna have predators in this tank, that would be like going after these guys, they also don't need the sand. And in my opinion, they definitely do better without the sand. They stay in better condition and better health. I've noticed that when I've taken my rays, for example, from having substrate in their tank to one day not, they poop sand for probably close to 6 months. You'll continuously find sand in the tank, and it's because they eat it a little bit. Yeah, isn't that gorgeous? So we got to get these guys, this tank's done. Let them breed, let them do their thing. They're absolutely happy. But you'll remember that all of these guys, 6 years ago, 7 years ago, were the size of these guys. Having this tank bare bottom is going to make it easier for them to find their food as well. I'm probably not going to feed day one, but I'm certainly going to feed here shortly. I'm excited to cross him with the girls in there. There's another girl that's smaller, and then the really big one's a girl, but in due time, or maybe these guys will cross. Leopoldi Pearl is a pretty interesting cross, but the pearls are just a relatively simple ray to keep. Now you see his disc lifting up right there? That, a lot of the times, looks like the beginning stages of disc curl, essentially dying. Nobody else is. So what is that? Water flow in the tank. The waves are going like this, and they're kind of going under him and going under him. So he's just relaxing, and the waves are kind of taking him up. But you'll notice how he keeps flicking his backs. So when they do curl, it's called the death curl. There's no coming back from that. But this one's fine. So don't stress if you see something like that. I also checked their bellies immediately to see if they had any sort of ammonia burn. Also, his little fins, and that's actually its dorsal. It's a modified dorsal fin. The disc on a stingray is actually a modified dorsal. Very cool, eh? Or sorry, pectoral. But even the back of his disc kind of lifting up a little bit there, if this camera would ever focus, is nothing to stress about. Again, that's flow in the water because we can look over here and there's nothing going on with him. And these guys are all just acting differently. I'll likely shut off the lights, feed them tomorrow, and begin plumping them up a little bit and growing them out to one day, you know, perhaps going in the 2000 and or another monster tank that I want to build, or, you know, but I think we'll definitely be using the 375 to kind of isolate and breed in. And now that it's a little prettier, you know, with the rocks and a little bit of sand, it just makes it a little more nicer to look at out here as opposed to being at bare tank. But yeah, isn't that awesome? Oh shoot, we have 6 stingrays now. I think it's pretty awesome. Stingrays are of course my favorite. So moving forward, it'll be maybe this will just be a stingray channel, or maybe I will get into some other fish. Do I need another Asian arowana? Or maybe a massive school of discus? What do you think that I should keep next and or get back into and or go back to, you know, kind of that sort of thing? I know that a lot of people aren't gonna be able to keep stingrays, but and or should even try to keep them, but that doesn't mean I can't. So let me know in the comment section below what you think I should try next, and or maybe one day you will get a ray. But if you do, please pay attention to things I say. Please learn with me and from me. I know sometimes a lot of the information on the internet can be difficult to follow and or who to trust or whatever. But stingrays have been my center focus for many, many, many years. And I think that track record kind of speaks for itself. And with the amount of companies or even some stingray breeders got into rays that started keeping rays because of my old videos or whatever, I love those types of stories. So let me know if you'd ever consider keeping stingrays in the future as well. But more importantly, what fish do you think I should get next that would go maybe I can quarantine and or keep it with these guys as they grow out? And or for the 2000 gallon. Let me know in the comment section below. See you in the next video.